We're continuing in our series of People of the Second Chance, and next week will be our last sermon in that series, and 2 weeks from today, we'll start a new sermon series called You Are Loved. What a great message, yes? You are loved by God and by others. The person sitting next to you, you have something in common with them. You are loved by God. We're selling some t-shirts as well. Some of you are representing the You Are Loved t-shirts. We're working on some stickers. I love stickers and t-shirts, and so we're working on that message of you are loved. But today, as we continue down this path of the people of a second chance, the word shame came into my thought, and I know that's not a word you want to hear on Sunday morning. It's not a happy word, shame. There's a lot attached to the word shame and where it comes from and decisions we make that cause shame, and shame becomes something that we wear and something that we hold. And so I don't want to make light of it today in how destructive and heavy and how dangerous shame is. If I said, who has experienced shame, everyone would raise their hand. But this morning, as we look into God's word, you can be set free from it. And it can be replaced with dignity and beauty and honor. And we all have stories of shame. Now, my story of shame is pretty light. But in the 80s, I worked at a mall. What's better than a mall in the 80s? Man, you pop the collar. You tight roll the jeans. You put the comb in the pocket. Yeah, I had a comb at one point. You're walking the halls of the mall in the 80s? What's better than a mall in the 80s? And even better than that, I worked at a place called Foot Locker. Hey, yeah, some of you know Foot Locker. And what a great place for uniquely me, a sneakerhead. I was around sneakers all day. I could smell them and try them on and get them for a discount and get them before my buddies could get them. I loved the job at Foot Locker. And in those days, they had a basketball goal above the counter. And so when people weren't coming in, I was working on the J. Loved it. But on a particular day, I had something going on, and so I didn't want to go into work, so I was trying to come up with an excuse to call my boss and say, hey, I can't come in today. Anybody ever been there? You're kind of like, I got a little scratch. I think I'm cold. I think I have a cold. We're coming up with the excuse, right? Well, I had already used that one before. And so I was really trying to think of how can I get out of my job that day. Now, don't judge me, and I'm not proud of what I am about to share, and I'm not proud of what I did. But my grandfather was ill and in his last days and in a senior adult care facility, and I'd been visiting him a lot. This is the enemy, okay? I told my boss, hey, I can't come into work today because my grandfather is failing. He's not doing well. I'm not sure how long he'll be here, so I have to go spend some time with him. What do you think my boss said? Oh, Doug, yes. He's just a great person. You're caring for your grandfather like that? Oh, of course you can have the day off. Yes! I'm on to whatever dumb thing I had planned. My father needed to get in touch with me that day. Some of you guys know where this is going. Wow. Picked up the phone because he knew I was at work. Called my boss and said, hey, may I speak to Doug? And my boss said, he's not here today. He had to deal with a family emergency. And my dad said, oh, really? What is the family emergency? Oh, this is Doug's father? Well, he is with your father, sir, and I'm so devastated that your dad is failing and he's not doing well. My dad took the message and then hung up the phone. You hung up phones back then? I don't know. I'm not sure what you do now, but you had a phone that you hung up. These guys in the front row are like, what? Hung up the phone. Then he found me, and we had a father-son conversation in which I brought shame to him, shame to our family. I was humiliated. Doug, how could you use your grandfather for your gain? How could you put our family, how could you lie like that for some dumb thing you were doing? I brought dishonor, discredit. I was humiliated. In fact, after it happened, I lost that job. My favorite job that I've ever had before this one. Lost that job, and I felt like everybody knew it. When I see somebody in the eye, I was just like, oh, man, they know my story. And so I started hiding. Even in my family, I knew my family knew it. I knew that I had used my grandfather for my, and I wanted to go and hide it. And I even felt like God was so disappointed in me, and I was just kind of in the corner, out of sight, undercover, just hidden. Shame. I thought everybody knew. As I worked through it, went in to get my last paycheck, my boss was like, I'm so sorry. You know, we don't meet many people that have the love of sneakers and hoops that you do. It's actually a compliment. It's a compliment. And I'm so sorry you lost your job. If you would have just told me what you wanted to do, I would have let you have the time off. So I didn't even have to lie to get out of it. The truth would have helped. The truth would have been fine. One decision brought this shame upon my head, upon my shoulders. The humiliation, darkness. We've all made those decisions, yes? We all have a story of shame, and some of you might be hearing it now. It might be replaying in your mind, and the enemy right now might even be reminding you of that shame, but we're not going backwards. There's no turning back. We are fixing our attention upon Jesus who sets us free. Shame. Open up your Bibles to Genesis chapter 3. We're going to find out where shame first showed up. The first story of shame. Now, some of you, I appreciate you adopting my crazy idea to have a digital Sabbath here on Sundays. Some of you might have not heard my digital Sabbath idea, but I have an idea that when we come into the house of the Lord, that we turn our phones off. I know there's a fear of missing out. Yes, that's a new word, FOMO, fear of missing out. It's a new word. Look it up. And we're missing out. I'm missing what's on Twitter. Twitter's a thing that you, okay, never mind. I don't know if everybody's on Twitter. We're just obsessed with our phones and what's happening. I think when we come into the house of the Lord, God has something better for us, a message that's better. And we want to disconnect from the world. And so I'm asking to take a digital Sabbath. Now, some of you have your Bible on your phone. I get it, and I understand that. But I think God's calling us to go deeper. And our phones can be that distraction that we might miss something that God has to say. So if you have your Bible, take and turn to Genesis 3. If not, use your phone, but don't use your phone for anything else while you're in this space, all right? Is that good? All right? I know it's not popular. You guys are all mean mugging me right now. It's not a great thing to say, but I'm passionate about it. Genesis chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. This is the word of the Lord. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals and the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" "Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful, and its fruit looked delicious. Let's pause there. Sin can entangle us, and it can look beautiful, and it can lull us in, and we can say, hey, it's not going to get me. Maybe somebody else, but not me. That looks so beautiful, so attractive. I'm going to try, because it's not going to get me, it's me. So it can deceive us by its look and by its potential and by what it will bring us. It looks so delicious. And she wanted the wisdom it would give her, so she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave it to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were open, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. When the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord walking about in the garden. So they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Then the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He replied, "I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. I was afraid because I was naked." "Who told you you were naked?" the Lord God asked. "Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat?" The man replied, "It was the it was the woman you gave me who gave me the fruit, and I ate it." Then the Lord God asked the woman, "What have you done?" "The devil made me do it," or "the serpent." "The devil made me do it," basically. "The serpent deceived me," she replied. "That's why I ate it." So shame showed up very early in our story. After they ate this forbidden fruit, the first thing they did was hide from each other because they felt shame. Then they hid from God because they felt shame. Then they bickered and blamed and made excuses for their choices. Why? Shame again. And shame has been working its dark plans ever since. Its most powerful dimension is how undetectable it is. Shame is so common and so subtle, many times we don't even notice it. It weighs on us, and it once gives us this desire to cover it up, to hide from God, to hide from others. But God doesn't want us to stay hidden. In fact, he wants us to join him. He invites us in to real life, the solution to every problem that you ever come in contact with. He invites us. He doesn't push us away, but shame causes us to hide, and God says, "Come as you are, not as you should be. Welcome home." Shame causes us to hide from him and others, but God calls us to himself, to join him, to follow him into life. One of my favorite quotes from a pastor in Atlanta, Georgia, Andy Stanley, he says this. It's so powerful, I just forgot it. I got it. "You either were a mess, or you are a mess, or you're one decision away from becoming a mess." Don't hide from each other. Don't hide from God. Don't hide from the place that brings you everything you need. Come into his way, into his arms. But shame is so heavy. So there's two things that help us with shame. Two things that can help us with shame. And some of these are in the book we're reading, People of a Second Chance, and the author is Mike Foster. Some of these words came from the book, so some of these will be familiar to you that are reading this book. There's two ways that we can deal with shame. The first one is to be less perfect, almost even to become an imperfectionist, to really own your flaws, Own who you are. God made you. Look at, read Psalm 139, one of my favorite scriptures. He knew you, the intricate. He knows every line on your hand, every wrinkle you have, every hair on your head. He knows you. You are known by God. Striving to be perfect creates guilt, creates shame. In fact, let me check again this week. Yeah, all the perfect people didn't show up. So to help with shame, we need to become less perfect. Listen, we're drowning in this sea of marketing that's selling us these products, these services, these ideas, and all of those things make us dissatisfied, discontented, depressed about who we are and what we have. We want our body to look like that. We want to have that, which I love that shop as seen on TV. There's all kinds of like little knickknacks you can go in there and buy, and it's supposed to change your life, right? Scrapes things off your feet. You know, you can sleep better. Yeah, there's a can you can spray on hair. Yeah, the problem with that is in the summer when you sweat, not that I know, but. So then we start to seek perfection in how we relate to each other. We seek perfection in our homes, with our children, with our friends, with our appearance. Our body image is disfigured because of shame and for comparing ourselves to others. I say this all the time. I'd love to be KD. Love it. Never going to happen. So, well, that's funny to you, Cecil. Comparing ourselves to others steals and robs us of joy and satisfaction. So then instead of enjoying our friends, our families, our life, we concentrate on trying to make them better and more perfect, and then we miss out on what God has for us. We miss out on the best that God has for us. He gave us our friends. He gave us his family. He gave us life. When we try to make it more perfect, it distorts it. I said this in the prayer, and you need to write this down. There's nothing you can do to make God love you more. There is nothing you can do to make God love you more. Quit hiding from him. Accept it. Walk into it. Embrace it. It's an invitation. We need to be less perfect and embrace who we are. You know, the root for the word shame in the Greek means to disfigure. To disfigure. Shame. There's a part of shame that means to disfigure. Remember going to those janky carnivals like in the 70s and stuff, and they had those mirrors? And when you looked in the mirror, it kind of disfigured you. Okay, no one went to the malls in the 80s, and no one went to carnivals? Okay, that's fine. That's fine. I guess it was a Midwest thing, East Coast thing. But when you go to these carnivals, they'd have these mirrors that you'd look into. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, gosh, thank you. Man, I was like, let's end. You'd look into that mirror, and it would just cause this disfiguring. When we look into culture for our value, it disfigures us. But when we look into Jesus, that's where we find contentment and satisfaction and peace and mercy and love. That's the reflection that is true. Hallelujah. Shame distorts the way we look at ourselves, the way we look at each other. And it warps the plan that God has for us. The greatest gift you can give one another is just be who you are. Flaws and all. God made you. His fingerprints are all over you. Look at Psalm 32:5. Psalm 32:5 says this. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. Also forgave the guilt. Did you get that? That's a big dimension. Forgave you, but also forgave the guilt. So the guilt is set free. The guilt is gone when we stop trying to hide. And we come into the presence of the Almighty God. So stop trying to be perfect. Second, the book kind of laid this out. This is the book's words, not my words, but the book laid it out. The second way to help with shame is to know your potholes. So as we're driving through life, there's going to be potholes or temptations that try to break us and break our resolve. You know what? I hate to break this to you, but you will not be good at everything all the time. Even things that matter to you. But life is meant to be lived and experienced. Once you become okay with your imperfections, you can become okay with other people's imperfections. I will say it again, Mama Ross. Thank you. Once you become okay with your own imperfections, then you can become okay with that person sitting next to you's imperfections. Your spouse's imperfections. Your teenager's imperfections. They don't think they have them, but they do. Know your potholes. Identify those temptations. Our imperfections are what makes us human. And they help us to relate to each other. Now the enemy knows where you are weak. And he knows how to attack. He knows where you are vulnerable. And that's the place he goes to. So you need to know those spots, those potholes. You need to know where the enemy is trying to attack you. And put that before God every day. Because we're not going back. Why would we? Back to a life of depression or a life of depravity or a life of emptiness. Why would we go back when we've caught a glimpse of Jesus who has come to set us free? Why would we go back? Some of us, the shame has been lifted. Why would we go back to it? So we need to open our eyes and know the same weaknesses that the enemy does. But shame is not welcome here. And fear is a liar. So know your potholes. Know your challenges. Put your eyes upon Jesus. Last scripture. Hebrews chapter 12. Beginning with verse 1 through 4. Hebrews 12, 1 through 4. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down. We strip off everything that has the potential of bringing us shame. We strip off everything that has the potential for us to blow it. If I was going to race someone in here. Let me look around and see who I knew I could beat in a race. So that would be Charvis. If I said, Charvis, let's race, because I know I could beat Charvis. I know I could beat Charvis. I wouldn't want to race him with a backpack on, right? You want to strip off everything so you can run. Not just run, but fly. Whatever is weighing on your shoulders, strip it off. We're not going back. Fear's a liar. Shame's not welcome here. We got to strip off everything, every little thing the enemy uses. You're not as good as they are. Don't you wish you had what they had? In fact, how'd they get that? They don't deserve what they got. How are they driving that car? Are you kidding? That's the enemy. And that's a weight. And then your expectation is distorted. Anybody with me? Strip off every weight and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. Not on a man on a stage under a spotlight. Not on one another. We keep our eyes on Jesus. What are you looking at right now? Because if it's not Jesus, it's disfigured. We keep our eyes on Jesus. Some of you are like, yeah, that's so simple. Yeah. He's inviting us in. We keep our eyes on him, and he sets us free. The champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility, choir, if you could get ready. Choir, if you could get ready. I travel with the choir, by the way. It's way around. Now he's seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people. Then you won't become weary and give up. After all, you have not yet given your lives in your struggle against sin. Sin is our most persistent enemy. It seeks to rob us of every good thing that God has designed for us. What God has for you, sin steals it, distorts it, takes it away, can present itself so attractively, lulls us into thinking that it cannot harm us. But we will never be able to live that full life that God has promised as long as we're entrapped by sin. And we must not blame it on anybody else. Well, my wife made me do it. Adam. I'm sorry, if your name is Adam, that wasn't meant for you. That was back to the story in Genesis. Adam said, my wife gave me the fruit. Can't blame our sin on anyone else. Again, that's the way the enemy distorts us. You know how you are deceived? Right, you don't, because you're deceived. You know how you're deceived? You don't, because you are deceived. Keep your eyes on Jesus. The good news is that there is, choir, you can come on out. Let me just pause for a minute. Because I know everybody's staring at the choir now, so let's just pause for a minute. The good news is there's no extent to which sin can entangle us that God's love does not overflow to set us free. Sin can entangle us. Not to the extent, though, of what God's love does for us. It overflows. It sets us free. Whatever the enemy has, God has something greater. Something better. As entangled as you think you are, God will set you that much freer. I know that didn't make sense English-wise. But as entangled as you are, God will break you free that way as well. Don't let pride distort you into thinking you will humiliate yourself if you say yes to God. That's pride. Oh, I don't need it. I don't want people to know that I'm in trouble, and that's pride. Don't let the enemy distort that and think that's humiliating. It was the best thing for me when I got caught. Some of you are afraid of getting caught. Looking over your shoulders. What's worse, getting caught or the fear of getting caught? I don't know. Best thing for me is when I got caught, I came into the light and understood who I was in Jesus. So as entangled as you are, you will be that free when you say yes to God.